Hi there, you're watching Great Lakes Now. I'm Anna Seisling, a producer with the program, and joining me are a couple of folks from our Shrinking Winter segment. We have Steve Ruberg, who's the lead of the Observing Systems and Advanced Technology Branch at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Great Lakes Environmental Research Laboratory. Quite a mouthful there. We also have Ayumi Fujisaki Manome, who is an assistant research scientist with the Cooperative Institute for Great Lakes Research. Both Steve and Ayumi, as I said, were featured in the Shrinking Winter segment, and they've got some updates on their work. Ayumi, Steve, it's great to see both of you again.
Good to see you, Anna.
All right, so I think we'll start with Ayumi. And Ayumi, in that segment, we know that you study, model, and forecast ice cover and water movement in the Great Lakes. And you talked about Great Lakes' annual maximum ice coverage, which was down. So reduced ice coverage in recent decades, a primary driver of this is global warming, right? I'm wondering, based on the things that you've looked at, are the trends still sort of going in that direction of less ice cover on the Great Lakes for this year?
Yeah, so looking at the current condition, it's still early December and ice just started to form at the limited part of the lakes, like northern coast of Lake Superior. And if you look at the water surface temperature, it's on average, it's I'd say it, given the large fluctuation, even though the overall declining trend, it's a little bit tricky to tell. If you look at the official forecast from NOAA, they're indicating that the chance will be equal both for above normal and, or below normal winter.
Okay. Your recent research has found a connection to the warm sea surface temperature in the Northeast Pacific to the placement of the winter jet stream, which is then affecting winter severity and ice cover in the Great Lakes. That's what you told me. I don't entirely understand what that means since I don't have your level of expertise in all things Great Lakes ice coverage. So can you talk a little bit about what that research means to sort of the broader scope of the work that you do?
Sure, yeah. So in conjunction of with global warming, we are seeing declining trend in ice cover, but at the same time, we are seeing a lot of fluctuations from year to year. So it's not really monotonic decrease, but, you know, decrease with a large year-to-year fluctuation. And a big factor impacting this large year-to-year fluctuation is how the jet stream or ridge trough system is placing over the North America. So if the Great Lakes area is within the trough, it tends to be exposed to very cold air coming from the Arctic. And what we found in a recent study is that displacement of jet stream is quite impacted by the temperature over Northeast Pacific.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for the update. Moving on now to Steve Ruberg. So Steve, in this segment, you talk a little bit about some of the kind of pressing questions that you and your team are trying to answer in relation to what is happening within the Great Lakes ecosystem during the winter months. And some of the challenges, as we heard in this segment, really have to do with the difficulty of figuring out what exactly is happening under the ice in the Great Lakes. And that's because of a gap in technology, really, that has existed up until pretty recently. And that's kind of where these new autonomous vehicles come into play. So I understand that now your team has been able to deploy this winter under ice AUV. So how many times has it gone out? Catch us up to kind of what's been going on with that and what's been discovered because of this AUV.
Well, there are a number of agencies throughout the Great Lakes that monitor conditions. And we monitor conditions to really understand the health of the Great Lakes. We typically do that, though, as a three season, so spring, summer, fall, and that's done very well. Where we have not been able to do as good about make observations as well has been in the wintertime. You have ice, you really have to have an ice-breaking or ice-hardened vessel to get out there, and there aren't many research. The research fleet in the Great Lakes has not been updated to include that. So what we're trying to do is use autonomous vehicles to collect some of the data that we would collect that determines the health of the fishery, the commercial fishery, the sport fishery. And that would be things like phytoplankton, zooplankton, that sort of thing. So we were able to successfully deploy an autonomous underwater vehicle for the first time, getting some of those observations in what we would consider meteorological winter, which starts December 1st. Not the seasonal winter, but the meteorological winter. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to get some of that those observations of the health of the lake. Just this week, we made a couple of runs out.
Very cool. And so if I'm remembering correctly, one of the AUVs that's highlighted in that segment is the Sabretooth, I believe. Is that the AUV that went out under the water?
Yeah, well, it's really interesting. Some of the most advanced technology in that regard, in using technology, has been developed, has been operated right here in Michigan. That's a company called Hibbard Inshore in Auburn Hills, Michigan, has been operating a Saab Sabretooth remotely operated vehicle. And then they were able to work with Saab and turn that into an autonomous vehicle. We were then able to charge that system with a fuel cell in the water, a really large one made by Teledyne Energy Systems. So it was a really interesting combination of contractor folks as well as federal folks to make this happen.
I'm wondering if you have any idea around what these findings could mean. I assume it's probably too early to really have been able to parse through and figure out exactly, the value of the information that's come in. But you talk a lot about figuring things out in terms of what's happening in winter months and the ways that this information and knowledge could really be beneficial to better understanding the whole Great Lakes ecosystem during the winter. So do you have any kind of hope of what you're hoping to uncover from this new area of information?
Yeah, what we hope to uncover is, these things all have to be done on a long-term scale to determine trends. And so, Great Lakes National Program Office, EPA's Great Lakes National Program Office, does certain assessments. What are the trends? Are the trends good in regard to phytoplankton and zooplankton, fish, those kinds of things? And so what we hope is that we've begun, what we have here is an initial way to routinely, winter after winter, get observations of those indicators that tell us indicate the health of the Great Lakes on a routine basis. So we're just at the beginning of that.
Okay. Well, Steve, I really appreciate the update. And again, so grateful for the work that both you and Ayumi are doing. Thank you both so much for joining me today.
Good talking to you, Anna.
Thank you. Ayumi, thank you so much as well.
Thank you so much.
I'm Anna Seisling, producer with Great Lakes Now. This has been an update on the shrinking winter segment. Thanks for watching.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.